deixa maravilhados antes para fazer uma apresentação sobre as tendências atuais de desenvolvimento na área da sustentabilidade, informações sobre produtos sustentáveis e comunicação. Por favor, desculpe.
Can you open the very much, and I think I just want to echo what Dr. Shayot said from Thailand, that I think we're not trying to give a message here that have an equilibrium program is a precondition for sustainable public procurement. It's just if you have standards and labels in your country that are institutionalized, then it makes your life, makes your work easier. So I think it's important to take this message with you, and I thank Dr. Shayot for making this point. And in my presentation, I just wanted to provide some overview of what's happening in this field at the global level. So in the area of product sustainability information, or consumer information, as I was referring to it in my early presentation this morning. So as I was mentioning, information is very important, and this information should be based ideally on the life cycle thinking to help us to identify, interpret and address critical areas for improvement. It's like an analogy with a crystal ball. So what can be measured, can be managed and can be improved. When I before we have the information, this is just some graphical representation of information supply chain. So before you get the information to consumers, first you have to have a data, some quantification, assessment based on ideally synchronized or harmonized methodologies along the specific indicators for product groups. And then you have the communication part, how you communicate this using different tools to consumers. And voluntary sustainability standards, EPD, so I provided some acronyms here. So I will be focusing in my presentation, and when I refer to product sustainability information or consumer information, I was mostly referring to the last two stages. But also at this technical side of quantification or assessment, there's also a lot of things happening, and they have their own challenges, and also a lot of work being done by UNEP through our life cycle initiatives, and I think this is a topic for another conference or seminar. So the value of this information, when it is available to the end users, and as I said, consumers being defined quite broadly, in a format that they can understand. And this is where the different standards and I think I missed my slide here. Why is not? Okay. Okay, there is one slide that for some reason is hidden, but I don't know how to unhide it. Well, I show it like this. So just, and this is a role for different information tools. Just to represent it schematically for you to have a better understanding, because when we talk about labels and voluntary standards, usually people refer to it as a jungle because there are so many of them. So just a bit of clarity. So you have the voluntary and mandatory approaches, and then the voluntary approaches, they have their own classification. We usually use the ISO classification, which already has been covered in the morning by Robin and also Dr. Shayot, briefly showed. So we have type 1, that is very much the topic of our workshop. Different labels, type 2, also very much used not by the companies but the retailers, like the second who is a sub-brand of the very large retailer in France, Carrefour. And then you have type 3, which are the declarations that usually have a very sophisticated format with a lot of information and values. There is also type 1 like. That is how we classify ourselves for our convenience. These are different voluntary sustainability standards that probably you all know. They're usually quite international and used in different countries. We call them type 1 like because they're also third-party certified, so they provide credible information But in comparison, as related to type 1, I saw type 1 classical legals, they usually focus on specific issue or stage of a life cycle. They're usually sector specific, could be focused on agricultural practices or energy use. They could also include social criteria or mainly focusing on social criteria, and they could be also management based. So some of the famous examples of this that you might know, and there are also many others. They are not strictly under the ISO classification, but they have quite an important presence in the market, and they usually refer to as the international standard. Then another approach that is also have been quite received a lot of attention, like here in France, there was some experimentation with environmental footprinting, indicating the value of CO2 emissions, water footprint, and maybe also one of the new emerging areas is the impact on the biodiversity of products. And it's also in a way communicated in the, to the final consumer in the form of specific values. Just a bit of evolution, this is based on the website that tries to track different eco-labels and voluntary standards that are used. And as you see, then the number has been growing over the last, especially two decades. And right now, according to this source, we have around 430 different labels that are used for different products. So you might be asking, why is there such a proliferation? Well, first of all, the response of the market to the growing pressure, both regulatory and non-regulatory pressure, the consumer awareness and demand. And also maybe it's related to the vagueness of the sustainable development definition. It has been done also on purpose, I would say, that to fit different context and understanding. And also the relates to the maybe vagueness of the definition of sustainable products. What we mean, this, as was discussed raised this morning, also green or sustainable. And it's also a response of the market. It's innovation and people, different stakeholders trying to find the best solution. So what are the trends that are taking place at the global level? We have at UNEP, we host the International Resource Panel, which is a panel composed of world international experts. And it conducts different studies on the related to the policy relevant aspects for sustainable resource management. So one of the studies they performed looking at the different impacts of the sustainable consumption production at global level and what they're using the life cycle approach. And what they found that the agricultural production and fossil fuels are the areas where we need urgently some improvements. And this, of course, again, taking life cycle approach, translates to the food, mobility, and energy appliances as a consumption clusters. So this is at the global level. In terms of market trends, business sustainability, so we talk about corporate social responsibility, but there is a gradual shift now. So if you look at the market leaders, to corporate sustainability, where corporate social responsibility has been seen as an add-on to the market, to the business strategies, now has become very much at the heart of the business strategies. So it's a key factor for competitiveness, market penetration, positioning, and brand reputation. And following that, companies have started, have been already for some years already putting aggressive sustainability targets, so there's some of them here. If you also look at the evolution of the corporate reporting and in terms of the terms that are used in this corporate reporting, you see that how gradually this just focusing on environment has been reducing and more focused on sustainability and also the social issues. Retailers, they also play a very important role, actually the most important, because they, as we refer to them, the gatekeepers between the consumers and producers. So the Walmart and other different retailers, they have their own strategies how to improve and influence supply chains and influence the choices of consumers. And it's not just Walmart as an international retailer, but also retailers in developing countries, they have their own strategies. Market trends, the rise of multi-stakeholder initiatives. So we have a number of initiatives that are quite important. They usually focus on specific sector or specific products. Sustainable Apparel Coalition, probably you've heard, Roundtable on Sustainable Palm Oil, Sustainable Packaging Coalition, the Sustainability Consortium, which is led by Walmart, is quite an important one. And they usually have objectives, these roundtables, they have objectives to develop some kind of common standards, to harmonize existing approaches among the different business companies and actors, the multi-stakeholders, so usually they're led by industry, but could be also by an NGO, and governments also play a role in these initiatives. Well, at the market in terms of consumption, the, I have some data, interesting data for the 2009, how the share of certified products have been increasing, and over the even the last few years, in spite of the financial crisis, there is indication that this number is not declining, but actually increasing. Consumption, we talked about the importance of sustainable consumption, so there is an emerging global class of middle class of global consumers, which right now accounts at almost 2 billion people, so which corresponds to the expenditure of $6.9 trillion. So there is a very interesting survey that has been done by National Geographic Green Deck study that each year they survey the patterns of sustainable consumption in especially emerging economies. So it also shows quite interesting results always that the most concerned actually not consumers from developed countries as we would assume, but emerging economies that they have preference for more environmentally friendly products. They're discouraged by false claims, greenwashing. They prefer to reuse and pre-owned goods. And in Europe, where there is presumably the highest level of awareness, 70% of consumers want the full disclosure of information about product impact. But also we don't have to forget that consumption is quite a complex phenomenon. So there are different factors at play. So it's not always that what awareness translates into the action. So there are different things that come into play. There was an interesting study also by Consumer Internationals about this emergent proliferation of different labels. So it has the potential to create confusion and eventual mistrust of consumers not to believe these labels. And at the same time, the labels that have some government involvement and backing of government are usually more trusted by consumers. Technology as one of the enablers or drivers. Internet has changed the access to information. We have access to information straight away whenever we want if we have internet googling things. So this is the age of transparency and the different tools for traceability. One of the interesting ones is a good guide that is quite popular in US. And right now it has also an application on the smartphone that you can scan the barcode and get the rating for different products. Right now it has 145,000 products included and rated according to the environmental, social, and I think health indicators. So the government trends, we talked about it, the active policies towards sustainable purchasing, and also the ways, efforts to stem greenwashing and different claims. So one of the, again, take an example from the USA, recently revised and launched the Green Guide for Environmental Marketing Claims, which one of the things that state is don't use terms green and sustainable because it's very difficult to substantiate them. I also mentioned about this food printing approach that is, for example, in France, they had this experimentation phase where asking different companies to experiment with environmental footprinting and displaying these indicators on products along the key impact categories. So it's CO2 emissions, water, biodiversity, and use of natural resources. And these are different approaches that companies used in this experimentation phase. at the same at the European level, so environmental footprint in our products. So right now, I think that it's open for consultation, this methodology that is for harmonized life cycle approaches, and I think they have a plan to launch the regulation at the beginning of the next year for harmonized life cycle approaches for environmental footprinting. And what are the possible policy implications? It could be included in the European eco-label to enhance it. It could be a separate voluntary scheme, or it could be a regulatory approach to make it mandatory. And one of the approaches that we're looking at, based on the consumer studies, that apparently this type of labels work the best based on the energy efficiency, where you have color codes used for different impacts, and then you have one global score. This is just one of the options that is being discussed now at the level of European Union. So there are a number of challenges: proliferation, how to create greater normalization and interoperability, there's growing consumer demand, and greenwashing is a problem, the credibility and transparency of these labels, sustainability as a holistic approach, so focusing on one indicator could be limiting the progress overall. Again, the methodologies that are not the methodologies, but they're not harmonized, so they cannot easily compare the results, and the information is quite fragmented, and also impact on SMEs. So outlook for the future, how to create more structure, clarity, and cohesion in this field, how to make these tools interoperable, integration of environmental social aspects for truly sustainability standards and labels, taking a holistic approach over the life cycle of products. And as I was saying, sustainability has become equal to quality in the business strategy. So this is a quick overview. I think I'm on time. No?
Temos ainda um tempinho para perguntas, não temos muito, mas quem quiser fazer perguntas, por favor. Um número muito grande de informação. Ok, parabéns.